I'm Sandesh from the University of Colorado Boulder, working under Professor Sang Teha in the systems lab. Today I'll be presenting the Castle over the air, a distributed scheduling for the cellular data transmission. Castle is a client-side adaptive scheduler that minimizes the load and energy. So we started with doing a small experiment in our campus using the AT&T, and then we usually assume, given a UE, the one with the larger number of the antenna or the stronger signal would give the much better speed compared to the one with the lesser number of the antenna or the less power signal. But that's not the whole case, because the speed or the throughput that we can achieve is not just dependent on that. It is also dependent on the crowd or the number of the UEs presented within the cellular channel. But this kind of the information is not usually given to the users. But we developed a model and the applications with which we can measure this cell load at a given point of time. So like shown in the figure, we have AT&T as well as the Verizon. In the same location, they both give the different load, because that depends on the signal, that doesn't depend on the signal. It depends on the number of the UEs present in that cellular channel. So if we consider the transmission, or the download process of all these UEs over the time, as the number of the UEs increases, they have to share the channel. As the time increases, as the number of the UEs increases, the time also increases, which means that the battery consumption in the each UE device could also increase. Since this is the Internet of Things era, where the number of devices are increasing, where they're sharing the channels, there's a high possibility as the devices increase, the battery consumption in the each device could be more. So what we wanted to do is to come up with the CSMA-like access method, where the device can access the channel and download the data in a shorter active time, so the battery consumption is less, and also to improve the utilization of the channel. So we developed a castle where we estimate the load, and then we estimate what could be the achievable throughput, and then schedule the download process. And it is based on a theoretical model that we built. And also we provide a software development kit, which is developed as an SDK, which is practical to run in any of the smart devices. So now we can think what could be the use cases if we know the cell load estimate could be achieved in the each UV. We can estimate what could be achieved in our channel. We can also do the cell selection and the reselection. Also, the load balancing could be done within the given scheduling. It could be used in the massive download, firmware, device communication, and also smart type of pricing. Consider the design challenges or the architecture of our car. And then using our theoretical model, it will the throughput, it will schedule the download process. So when we were building the model, we had to consider the intercell interference, which plays an important role for the cell load estimation. And also, since the goal is to lower the utilization of the power consumption, the model has to be lightweighted. So we designed the machine learning model and then used it as a pre-trained data or a lookup table within the each UE. And it has to be something practical so that we can use it in all the smart devices. So we developed a SDK as well. So we can have the maximum battery efficiency. Similarly, it can be an application-aware scheduling algorithm. And whatever the castle that we have developed is in a distributed manner. It's not centralized or it's not controlled by a single base station. And it also coexists with the other device which might not use this castle algorithm. So what is the basic idea of the castle? So if you look at the cellular channel, we keep sensing the channel every second or a given time framework, and then we have the throughput threshold that we want our application to have. And once the throughput that we measure is crossed the threshold, we would want to download the, we want to start the download process because we think that channel condition could be favorable during that time. And also another thing that we should consider is that if multiple UEs see the same condition, there's a high probability all the UEs would start download process at the same time. So we wanted to do some sort of random backoff once it satisfies the condition. And after the random backoff is done, it again measures the channel and then check the condition. If it is satisfied, then it starts the download process. Now, the important two factors that here to be considered as are, one is the A star, which is the threshold. Another one is the random backoff. So these are the two important factors. So how do we measure this? This is measured or computed using our theoretical mathematical model, where we want to minimize the energy consumption. So we represent it as an equation of the load that is present in the cell channel and whether the cell UE is the UE in the cell is downloading or not, and also the signal strength that it receives. The first step is to maximize the throughputs or the bytes that we can download, which is once again dependent on the total bytes that has to be downloaded and the number of the active UEs. And once we maximize the energy equation and then obtain the value of the AN star and then the RB, we also have to consider the time that is to be taken to download. And this has to be lesser than or equal to this, the desired download time. Now, once we compute the E of CT, which is equal to DDL, then we can obtain the value of the A star, from which we can obtain the value of the RB as well. But if you look at the AN star and the RB, it also depends on the number of the active UEs present in the cellular channel, which is difficult to find out in a practical situation. So we came up with the concept of auto-tuning, which I'll explain in the further slides. So the basic strategy is the given UE at a given point of time measures what is the achievable throughput, and then it checks if it is greater than the threshold that's favorable for the given cellular condition. If it is, then it will do the random backoff, and after the random backoff, if it still satisfies the condition, and then it starts the download process. So the same is depicted in the given picture. If we see, we have user A and then the user B, and they both satisfy the condition, but will not start the download process unless they go through the random backoff. So the one UE device will fail or will not win the channel because the other UE has already started the download process. So now how do we estimate or measure this achievable throughput at every point of time? Is basically based on the SINR that we get at a point of time and then the cell load. And also the one of the important thing that we saw during our experiments is as the value of the SINR increases, the achievable throughput will also increase. So the second important factor that we need to consider is the cell load that is present in that particular cellular channel. Now, so how do we get that cell load? If you look at the LTE frame structure, the three important factors are RSSI, which is the received signal strength indicator, the RSRP, which is reference signal received power, and then the RSRQ, which is the ratio of the RSSI, and then the RSRP. The RSSI is usually the linear average of all the signal that is received, and then the RSRP, which usually indicates the reference signal. So now, if we look in this diagram, the cell is completely loaded. That means the RSSI which is received is not just the summation of the RSRP, but it's the summation of all the subcarrier powers. But if the cell is not loaded, that means the RSSI, like the shown in the blue diagram, the RSSI would be just the summation of RSRP. Since the RSRP, the RSRQ could be used to measure the cell load within the cellular channel. So we found the theory by doing the experiment and using some theoretical model. Being the maximum RSRQ, which is minus 6, less or no cell load. And similarly, we have the minimum RSRQ, which is minus 13 dB, where the cell load is maximum. So to do this, all this experiment, we had our own test bed where we had the EPC and the base station, the UEs, and to introduce the mobility and interference, we had some signal attenuator, and also we had monitoring devices. So basically what's happening is within the shield box, we keep the cellular or the UE devices, which sends the channel and then uses our castle modeling and predicts the load and also measure the throughput. And to check the ground truth, we also use the monitoring tool and collected the load information from the given cell. So like I mentioned, as the value of the RSRQ increases, the cell load reduces, and we had found the bound as a minus 6 and then minus 13. So we cross-checked with the experimental results. So if we see that in the diagram, when the RSRQ is minus 6, the cell load is 0. And then when the RSRQ is minus 13, the cell load is maximum. And also, so we can say RSRQ is the single factor that can decide the cell load, but that's not completely true because the UE devices are not always at the center of the cell. They can move to the edge of the cell as well, in which the inter-cell interference is occurs. So if we measure the RSRQ value along with the different distance with the inter-cell interference, the RSRQ values changes, which means the cell load that it is depicted by just measuring the RSRQ will not be accurate. So what we did is we developed a machine learning model considering the different signal strength or the signal values, and which will give us the accurate the cell load that is present. And also the cell load that it gives is in terms of the four different classes, the one being the lesser than 25%, the other being the 25 to 50, 50 to 75%, and then the last class being the 75 to 100%. And then if we look at the accuracy of the machine learning model that we developed and comparing it with the just RSRQ based estimation, it's 91% if it is at the center of the cell. But if we move it to the cell edge, it is 83%. But it still outperforms the cell load estimation that is given directly by the RSRQ value. And also the ultimate goal of our castle was to reduce the energy consumption. So that means we should be able to try to reduce the download time as well. So one of the base work that we referred or when we started was the peek and sneak from the LoadSense MobiCom 2013 paper, the Microsoft Research India. So when we compared our work of download time, again keeping the device at the center, middle, at the edge, the castle outperforms all the other algorithms by 5 to 53 and 70 to 87% respectively. And also the another important thing to consider is the high spectral efficiency. Once again, we compared our castle work with the existing work, and the spectral efficiency, that's the bits per second per hertz, the castle achieves much better performance than the existing work. And also we measured the castle considering the mobility case. Once again, both the stationary and then the mobility, the download time as well as the spectral efficiency is much better in terms of the castle compared to the other work. I mentioned auto-tuning could be one of the method with which we can measure or with which we can know the number of the active UEs present in the cell. So what we did was we used something like a CSMA technique where if you consider the CSMA, if there are no competing device, then there is nothing has to be backed off or nothing has to be weighted. So similarly, we start assuming that N of t is equal to 1, where the throughput achieved could be maximum. And then we keep increasing the N of t till that A star is or the threshold is greater than 0. And then we compared our auto-tuning technique with the N-known method, which is nothing but when we knew the number of the UEs present in the cellular channel and other priority scheduling algorithm from the base station. And the auto-tuning techniques performs similar to the N-known. Sometimes it also, after some point of time, it also outperforms the N-known method. And also we evaluated our castle in the real network like the AT&T and then the Verizon. So the image shows the results from the AT&T. So if we see during the morning time, maybe from 3 a.m. to 9 a.m. where the cell load is very less, so the castle will schedule the download process. So the throughput could be achieved much more. That means the channel or the spectrum is much more efficiently used. So to put it Altogether, the castle that we have developed, consider the inter-cell interference and the cell load and the throughput estimation, which is done purely based on a theoretical model. And also, we do not have to modify any of the UE device. That means we don't have to route it or we don't have to enable any diagnostic mode, because we have developed the castle SDK, which is much more practical. We can just call it with any of the application that you want to integrate. So that's the castle, which is a theoretical model that we have built, and to minimize the battery consumption and to achieve the maximum throughput in a very less amount of time. Thank you for listening, and I'll take the questions now.